So thank you for joining me. Today I'm going to show you how to answer this question. So in this question, we're given a set S, and this set S contains vectors from R3, which all satisfy this condition here, so this linear condition in X. Now we're tasked to do three things. We're told that we need to find three distinct elements of S, we need to show that S is a subspace of R3, and we need to give a geometric interpretation of this result. So this first part is quite easy. All we're going to have to do is write down three distinct elements. The second part, well, we'll have to go for a general argument, and that's going to take a bit of time. And the last part, well, I guess we'll see how hard that is when we get to it. So how are we going to find three distinct elements of S? Well, let's just take a look at this equation and see what solutions we can come up with. Now, looking at this, a fairly obvious solution is to just take all three components equal to zero. So I'm going to take my first example element to be the vector 0, 0, 0. So 2 times 0 plus 3 times 0 minus 4 times 0 is 0. What about the second element? Well, looking at this, an easy thing to do might just be to balance out these two first terms. So what I mean is, let's take our last term to be 0, and to balance these two out, well, let's take 3 and minus 2. So 2 times 3 is 6. 3 times minus 2 is minus 6. So that's a nice example. And we can do the exact same thing with these two terms. So let's set the first component to be 0. And I'm just going to take a 4 and a 3 to balance that out. And those are three distinct elements of S. Alright, so how do we show that S is a subspace of R3? Well, we want to use the subspace theorem, but to use the subspace theorem, we need to prove three things. Firstly, we need to prove that the zero vector from R3 is in S. Then we have to show that if we take two elements of S and sum them together, we also have something in S. And finally, we need to show that if we take something from S and some scalar from the reals, then that scalar times that vector, we have to show that that is also in S. So this first one is actually fairly easy. We can just do it right here on the board. So how do I prove that 0, 0, 0 is in S? Well, 0, 0, 0, the zero vector from R3, is in S since, well, since if I just take the components from 0, 0, 0 and plug it into the condition, I see that the condition holds. So I see that 2 times 0 plus 3 times 0 minus 4 times 0 and all that, so is equal to 0 as required. So yes, I can confidently tell you that that vector is in S. So let's show that second property. Let's show that if we take two elements of S, then their sum is also in S. Let's take X and Y to be elements of S, and let's consider what happens when we look at their sum X plus Y. Well, I want to know if this vector lies in this set, and it's only going to lie in this set if it satisfies this condition. So let's have a look at this condition. So let's plug the components of X plus Y into that condition and see what happens. So plugging the components of X plus Y into the condition gives, well, it gives you 2 times x1 plus y1 plus 3 times x2 plus y2 minus 4 times x3 plus y3. So all I've done is I've taken the components of x plus y and put it into that condition. Now, if we look at this, we can see that it can be rewritten as 2 times x 1 plus 3 times x, 2 minus 4 times x, 3, adding on 2 times y1 plus 3 times y2 minus 4 times y3. So all I've done is I've taken this combination and rearranged it to give me this. But these two quantities are quite familiar. I know that because x is in S, that this quantity must be 0. And I also know because y is in S, that this other quantity must also be 0. So written this way, this is 0 plus 0, and of course 0 plus 0 is 0. So that means x plus y is in S. And actually there's a special name for this property. This is called closure under addition. So let's conclude that hence S is closed under addition. Okay, so the final property we need to show is that if we take a vector from S and we multiply it by a real number, then we also get something in S. So let's start the same way as before. Let's just take x to be an element of S, lambda to be a real number, and let's consider the vector lambda times x. So again, I want to show this is an S. So the only way to really do that is to show that this vector satisfies this condition. So let's take the components and plug it into that condition. Plugging the components of lambda x into the condition gives, so it'll be 2 times the first component of lambda x, which is 2 times lambda x1, plus 3 times lambda x2, minus 4 times lambda x3. Now, quite nicely, if I look at this, there's a lambda in every term, so this will be the same as lambda times 2x1 plus 3x2 minus 4x3. Because x is a vector in S, you know that this quantity here must be 0, so this is lambda times 0, since x is in S, and lambda times 0, well, that's just 0. That shows me that the components of this vector satisfy this condition, so therefore this is in S. And there is a special name for that. So lambda x is in S. That means that S is closed under multiplication by scalars. Okay, we've shown that S contains the zero vector from R3. S is closed under vector addition, and S is closed under multiplication by scalars. Now, there's one more thing I really think you have to do to really tie this all together, is to make the conclusion that by the subspace theorem, S is a subspace of R3. If you think about it, all we've done is show three very special properties. It's really the subspace theorem which does the rest of the work and tells me that this really is a subspace of R3. So the final part of this question was asking us to give a geometric interpretation of what just occurred. So if you have a look at the equation, what's really special about this equation is that it's the equation for a plane and it passes through the origin. And both of those are important. So this needs to be linear in x1, x2, x3. And this has to be 0. It has to pass through the origin. So that's going to be my interpretation. Geometrically, planes passing through the origin give subspaces. So there was nothing in my proof that really hinged on what these constants here were. just the fact that this was the equation for the plane and that it passed through the origin.